shining in every atom. Oh, hidden life, embracing all in one, in oneness. May each who feels himself as one with thee know that he is also one with every other.
Thanks, Ramesh. We now have the interreligious prayers, beginning with the Gayatri Mantra.
Om Bhurbhuvasvah Tatsavitur-Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Diyo Yona Prachodayat. Om Bhurbhuvasvah Tatsavitur-Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Diyo Yona Prachodayat. Om Bhurbhuvasvah Tatsavitur-Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Diyo Yona Prachodayat.
Now have the Parsi prayer by Freni, the Zoroastrian prayer.
Thank you. Shri Pak Dadar Auramazdani Madad Ho Joji Gorje Kore Avajiad Pak of Shu Neshahe Faredun Bapak Beram Yazet Panabad Ham Jartoshti Madadgar Ham Papi Negedar of Shu Neshahe Faredun Bapak Beram Yazet Madadgar. Yatha ahu varyo, yatha ratush, ashachit hacha, vanghe ush, dasdau meningo, shaute nanam, angyush mazdai, shatrem chai, ahurai aim, drigobyo, dadatavasta rahem. Yatha ahu varyo, yatha ratush, ashachit hacha, vanghe ush, dasdau meningo, shaute nanam, angyus mazdai, shatrem chai, ahurai aim, drigobyo dadatavastarahem, ashem vahu, vahishtem vasti, Usta asti, usta ahmai, yadeshai, vahishtai, ashem. Sarosh yazad nipana ho joji. Thank you.
Have the Christian prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
I don't think Gulu's here, so we will not have the Sikh prayer. I now call upon Mr. Janaki Ram to introduce our speaker.
Good evening, all the participants. I have pleasure introducing Dr. Sadanand Shivram Rasal. He is a qualified medical doctor from Pune University, and he is owning a multi-specialty hospital and a diagnostic center. He became a disciple of yoga, spirituality, and holistic medicine. I am amazed when I read this bio data that at such a young age, being a medical doctor and owner of such a big hospital, he took sannyasa life for 14 years, and he spent that time research based on the teachings of Guru Atma Mauli. He specialized in cellular healing and also about cellular aging. The research work included biochemical disease makers, immunity makers, chakra physiology, hormones as health indicators and disease makers, alternative approach to medicine with various other psychoimmunology methods, about which I'm sure you'll be covering during this talk. And he has specialized in diagnostic tools and methods. He's a founder of Atma Veda Yoga Private Limited. I would recommend all the participants, you can also tell your friends, to visit LinkedIn profile and read about him, as well as on the Facebook, Atma Veda Yoga Private Limited. I visited all that before coming to attend this talk. Very impressive. We are all eagerly looking forward. He is bringing up what is called UUP, utilization, expansion, and promotion of knowledge for Atma Veda. And his specialty is in bringing healthcare, life science, and research, and making healthcare for all the people, particularly those who cannot afford in villages and two-tier and three-tier places, a true reality. So what our Prime Minister is giving a clarion call, so he's one of those who has heard that and he has dedicated his lifetime to that. And I would also like to add, most of the participants, we keep hearing about Atma or soul, but it is supposed to be beyond all five senses and mind. So we are very eager to listen to Dr. Sadanand, how he is integrating Atma Yoga Veda and about to health and prevention of diseases and cellular changes and transformation. Over to you, Sajani.
Thank you, Mr. Janaki Ram. And now it's over to Dr. Sadanand.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir, and all the dignitaries who are present here. Especially thanks to the school. I like the name. Ancient wisdom, two names which relate with me, which relate with my journey. And as sir said, yes, those 14 years of people called me like Munna Bhai MBBS, chemical locha, you know. So that 14 years was for this ancient wisdom, because intellect, I thought, gave me only a chance to look in the exterior. But our ancient wisdom, it gives us quite great vision to see beyond intelligence. Today, without wasting anybody's of your valuable time, I will come to my subject of talk today, which Sajani ma'am and all her team have given me a chance to present to you. It is a passion. This topic is a passion for me, and it's a reality. So like when we see a movie, there is always a disclaimer, like the movie is not based on any true event, or no animal is hurt, no human being is hurt, no religious feelings are to be hurt, so. So I will also have a disclaimer that whatever I express today, it will wholly and solely be related to only the things which I have known on myself, which I have learned in my that 14 years of life, or maybe a life before. So it will be something true which I know. It could be right, it could be wrong. You are the best people to judge about it. So my today's topic is about building healthcare on spiritual values. Now, when the topic comes, my topic itself has three parts, you know. So these three parts are like healthcare, spirituality, and health. Now, looking ahead to this three parts, I would like you to visualize for a mind, because we are here for a connect with spirituality. So spirituality connects with visualization, right? So visualization can be intellectual or something beyond that. Intellectual is something that we see, perceive, and spirituality is something that we feel, understand, and experience. So just for a while, you think about this topic, building healthcare on spiritual values. Three components are there. One is health, Second is healthcare. The third is spirituality. Right. Now, healthcare, like Sarji has already mentioned, our very nice beloved PM, his great mission of Atmanirbhar Bharat. And main thing what he is wanting to do is Ayushman Bharat. So these two things are interrelated. Atmanirbharta, if it comes from spirituality, if the source is spirituality, I think nothing greater than any direction that can be shown by our country to the whole world, because our richness of wisdom in Vedas, our scriptures, our religions, they give a great insight into what should be health and what should be healthcare. So when I say healthcare, naturally looking ahead, you will only see certain things that will come in your mind. That is a hospital or a clinic or a lab or a yoga practitioner or Ayurvedic doctor or a homeopathic doctor. Something that we related with this stethoscope or a plus sign. Now they have changed the sign. It is our perception. It is our experience. This has been what has been catered to us. So we relate it with that. If I say health, immediately what will come in your mind is good habits, lifestyle, yoga, wellness, lot many things, gymming, whatever, say aerobic, whatever type of exercises, so many types of diets, they also come, that will come into the section of health. When we come into spirituality, we will generally have something related to religion. Or maybe, what you say, a mission, or mostly related to God. You know, we relate spirituality to God. So, in general, when I talk of healthcare, it is a materialistic aspect. In spirituality, it is something related to above us, higher consciousness, that is above ourselves. And health, something what we perceive externally, maybe a little bit ahead. People are talking about mental health now more, openly than it was before. So these are the present concept of what we think as healthcare, spirituality, and healthcare. Looking ahead, if we go to the next slide, I will just have a view of what our country or maybe the whole globe. It is just managing its resources in healthcare. My interest is healthcare, and my topic is bringing spirituality values into healthcare. So if you look at health, I will talk about our country, right? And presently under leadership of our Prime Minister, before also it was there, but now it is very, passionately being done. I see almost above 90%, 80% of our things that are related to health that are done by the government. Many people who are there, they may not agree with this, because we stay in cities, and in cities you see the infrastructure of private healthcare. But cities are just 15% of our country. 85% of my country is in the rural region or away from the city, like sir said rightly, second tier, three tier city. And there I am very sure, and I've been working in rural for past many years also. So the healthcare is basically provided by government. And I think whatever our government has been doing in healthcare, in the tertiary level and secondary level, I think the globe has to learn from us. We are really a great model for them. Corporate sector, when it comes to health, I will say it is all about business. I am also corporate. How can I be different from them? Let's see whether I am different or not. But health for that is all about gadgets that record your health readings or some laboratory diagnostic things like Tata. He has taken 1 mg. So lot many tools are coming. So lot many corporates are coming. Corporates into wellness, corporates into lifestyles, corporates into counseling. So that is the health, but the present share of service providers in section of health is hardly less than 10%. Third is NGOs. NGOs, yes, in cities as well as in rural areas, so I can say across India, better than private players or corporate players, NGOs are doing a great job in health. We have greatly seen that in COVID pandemic also. When we talk about spirituality, no government can promote any particular kind of spirituality. Yes, it can believe in certain values, just as our country is doing, and that is inclusive and taking everyone together. So government across the world, they are taking care of their citizens, they are taking care of their countrymen. So they have a very less role to play in spirituality, yes, but the leadership, if it is believing in spirituality, spiritual values, then the country is run very nicely and it progresses in a very harmonious way. Corporate in spirituality, nowadays they are into it. I am also corporate Atma Veda Yoga. My name is Atma Veda Yoga. So I am also into it. How we are into it, why are into it, every corporate owner or the founder, they know the reason. Some are driven by passion. Some are driven by funds. Some are driven by opportunities. Some are driven just by chance. NGOs in spirituality, I will say, NGOs are 93% of spirituality. I consider every ashram, every guru, every master as an NGO, because he is the person, that organization is a person which is taking care of health and spirituality, social values, even building of our nation. So it is a great step there. When it comes to healthcare, yes, corporate is playing a role here. It has come up with great five-star hospitals, nice facilities, with great penetration of insurances across the stream of strata of our society. Corporates have come up now. It's open India for all, and healthcare for all. So corporates have taken a lunge into it. Private players, we have to greatly salute them. They are playing a very great role, second to the government. So that is it. NGOs, they are also into healthcare. We see off and on in various places, NGO-run hospitals, NGO-run healthcare units doing great job. I stay in Pune. I have Inlax Budrani here, Sadhu Vaswani Mission, doing a great job. Though I am not related to it, but as a child, as a student, as a medical student living in Pune, I have greatly seen that. So this is it. My interest is spiritual healthcare. Spiritual healthcare is mostly predominantly done by NGOs at present. NGOs especially who are related to yoga, who are related to naturopathy, who are related to Ayush. NGOs also related to, I don't remember his name. I follow this doctor. He's from Karnataka only. I am very weak in memory, but he has done a great job in cardiology. I mean, he has worked greatly in heart diseases. I think it's Chitra Dham or something like that, Chitra Institute. So great people like that who are working for a beautiful cause of healthcare. So going ahead, I will first say, like, let's discuss a little bit about health before coming into my perspective about spiritual values in health. Whenever I speak of health, or whenever you close your eyes and meditate on the word health, you will generally have an idea of medical health, diagnostic health, accepted health, and mental health. Medical health, like everyone, you must be doing your test regularly. If I ask you, are you having any issues? You will say, no, we are very healthy, fit and fine. So medical health, unless and until you are not diagnosed with a disease, you don't have any medical health issue. It will call it as medical health. Diagnostic health, if your diagnostic tests are normal, just like most of the companies or even people now, due to this pandemic, they have been doing the health assessment by lots of health checkups. We have lots of startups, you know, who are offering these health checkups, blood test and lot many things. So if you do this, if the diagnostic reports are normal, I will call it as diagnostic health. You are very healthy, right? The report says so. Accepted health. Every person has his own mind of what is health, you know. So anybody who is having little knee pain, he will not call it as a health problem. He will say, I am healthy. Anybody who is having little neck pain, or anybody who is having a bit of palpitation, any small minor issues, he will call himself as healthy, because he has accepted it as a health. He has accepted this problems not as a problem, because mind pursues only that thing as a problem which fears you, which bears you, which creates panic in you. Then only we call it as a problem. Otherwise, we never call it as a problem. Mental health, yes, now people are talking about, not openly, because again this is something related to the accepted health. So mental health, if you feel better, if you feel not stressed, you call it as you are healthy. But how to define stress? Everyone has his own definition. I think the second point of this particular slide, diagnostic health, I don't think there is any diagnostic method in present medical science that diagnoses the stress and it affects on your health. So we can only give tablets to the patient, saying that, oh, this is because of stress, it could be hypertension, so and so and on. So this is our concept of health, of present, our mind, intellectual intelligentsia, and even the healthcare system. Spirituality, like I said, if I talk of spirituality, it is generally discussed in certain particular things only. God, wellness, peace, love, worship, and yoga. Sorry for the spelling mistake of the word worship. So that is it. I will not elaborate on this, because spirituality is such a topic that every person knows. I know it. So sometimes it is very difficult to talk on spirituality or teach spirituality. So spirituality, I am surely aware you all people must be more knowledgeable about it. So that's it when I come up to spirituality. If I go ahead, healthcare, like I said, healthcare, present healthcare, what you are being offered, what you are getting, what you are finding, what you are opting, what is your choice, okay, how you give relevance to which healthcare is better, which healthcare is not right, which is right. So it all depends on this particular thing. Who is giving the best diagnostic test? Who is offering the best test? Who is having the great therapeutic range, mostly related to the qualification of a doctor? Before we enter his clinic, we see the qualification that guarantees us, yes, he is qualified to treat us, and then we enter it. Great faith on healthcare, which people have. Then online services, offline services. COVID has brought online services quite in the forefront. The present healthcare startup, the present digital India, it is giving a chance for this online health services, and it is a need of the hour also. Preventive healthcare, yes, we talk a lot about it. We do a lot about it. In our medical education, there is a subject called as preventive medicine we are taught. But in preventive medicine, we are always taught about diseases. Communicable diseases, epidemics, and so on, contagious diseases. Preventive healthcare has a great meaning. We will elaborate ahead, but this is what present healthcare is. General care at home, yourself, or in your pharmacist. You just go to the pharmacist, ask for a complaint, or describe a complaint. He gives you a tablet. He is your best trusted healthcare partner, I think so. Critical care, something this pandemic has brought to the forefront, the requirement of more critical care, whether the critical care was right or wrong, whether improvement needs to be done, and what are the limitations of critical care. So this is the general healthcare that we think of. If we go ahead, now I have just described you what is there at present, and now as Sarji, who introduced me, sorry, I have just forgot the name. Please pardon me for that. But like a fatherly person, he introduced me. So this is my introduction, right? Building healthcare on spiritual values. What do I mean of it? Atmaveda Yoga, forget my name of my company. Or forget this as a startup. But it has me in it. So what is that? It has three basic things. If you want to build a healthcare on spiritual values, I'm not talking of spirituality as a healthcare. I'm talking of bringing spiritual values into healthcare. So I'm not talking of any particular pathy, because spirituality is not a pathy. Spiritual values is about how you do, what you think, what you do, and what your passion lies. So I divide it into three parts: Atmaras, Atma Samvad, and Atmanirbhar. So if what I did in those 14 years was, I was also having a successful hospital. I was a corporate, was running a hospital and a diagnostic center. All was running good. I was one of the youngest chaps to excel in that business in my area of PCMC, that is Pimpri-Chinchwad Municipal Corporation. And that time also very enthusiastic and wanted to serve the best. So I was having the best equipment in the Pune district that way. So when I went into this journey of my 14 years, I understood two words are very important: truth and trust. Now, truth and trust is not something that we ask from someone. It is something which we give to the other person. Absolutely, I have no doubt that every doctor, he also does that. But we have to have a step ahead. I will elaborate laterly what I mean by this. So this truthfulness and trustworthiness is very important, because the person who comes to you, he just believes you. He thinks you have the solution for his problem. Whatever you offer to him, he just takes it. The truth, what you are offering, the truth about what you are offering, only you know. So you are the whole. So if you raise in yourself this nectar of Atmaras, it is truth and trust. Sarji explained how I see Atma. I was not fond of looking at God. I understood that I am very less capable of understanding God. That 14 years, I had always a question: if I worship Ganesha, if I worship Shiva, if I see him, what am I going to do next? If I come down and tell all people I have seen him, they will ask me, show me. So I won't be able to show. And I have a thing, either I create a very big idol of him, or I dress myself in attire which relates with him, and then people start believing me. That did not, kick me. That did not give me any kick inside. So I understood him only in two ways. He is the most truthful person, God. He is the most trustworthy person, God. So if I want to understand him, if I want to learn something from him, if I want to bring some qualities in me, and whatever I do in the future, I have to start with these two points. No doubt, my previous career was based on that, but still I have to do something more. I identified something more. Truthfulness, something which not what is accepted. Something which is ingrained in every part, every step, every thought, every action, every process of what you are going to do. Same thing with trust. Second point in the journey, what I found was Atma Samvad. Atma Samvad, something with me, and when Atma is within you, when you have a communication with yourself, it is called Atma Samvad. Now, when a patient comes to a doctor, when you are addressing a community, suppose my country is drafting a healthcare policy, my country is drafting a rural healthcare policy, say it is Ayushman Bharat, two points has to be considered in that. If I am a representative of that, of my country, two points are important: compassion and service. I hear Dalai Lama say one day, His Highness Dalai Lama, I heard during the pandemic time, he talked about passion and compassion in healthcare. When lots of COVID cases were there, lots of deaths were happening, Karuna and Seva. These two things, what happens? Truth and trust, compassion and service, along with your intellect, it gives you an edge. It gives you something called an increased success rate, because you think wide, you are not pinpoint. You think more beyond what you are seeing. So that is Atma Samvad. Next is Atmanirbhar. Whenever anything you build on truth, trust, compassion and service, it is going to be sufficient. Because only such things can be created on this core values, where there is a passion. I, as a startup, I, as a young man, I always loved to read about Tata, because though it is a big corporate, the passion, you know, I see him in a very different angle. So he gives me how we see God. I see him giving a way ahead. I see him giving me guidance about what I have to do ahead. So this is what I say about building healthcare on spiritual values. What we have built, Atma Veda Yoga, it is on this trust, truth, compassion, service, passion, and making it sufficient. Now, if that sufficient passionate service is offered to the country, I am very sure our PM's dream of Atmanirbharta and Ayushman Bharat is going to be a success, because he's a passionate man. Do not please judge me as some promoter of him, but I just see people, I love them. I understand their actions, so that gives me some impulse, you know. Now, going ahead, if you see present healthcare system, present rays of what we are there, what we are going ahead, big unicorns in healthcare, lots of corporates investing in healthcare. So what it is? It is turning out into a shark investors, funders, stock equity and PPP, public-private partnership. I have colored it as a dark, not to say that it is wrong, just to highlight it. This is the thing that is rocking the world today. This is the thing that is having a great speed nowadays, and it is working. How I see ahead? Healthcare, yes, this should be there, but my belief is responsibility. Any startup, when we want to bring spiritual values, I am absolutely of not the belief that anything that is spiritual needs to be free. I said it has to be trustworthy, it should be truthful. It should have these obligations to serve the nation, to the community, to the person. These are responsibility, service, growth and delivery, customer satisfaction, liability, trust, and POP, public-oriented partnership. Healthcare is a business, but it is a noble business. It is a noble profession. Here, public, the person, the community, that is the forefront. Healthcare cannot be a full-fledged corporate just for gains. It cannot be, because it is not designed to be that way. The whole soul of healthcare is responsible service with truthful passion. So that is what I love, public-oriented partnership. Now, liability, trust, responsibility, service, satisfaction, samadhan, and samadhi. These are the words which are related to spirituality, right? So if it is related to the spirituality, healthcare can be spiritual. This is the things what we want. So what are the spiritual values? Looking ahead, I want to explain you. Let's come to the core topic of what are the spiritual values which a healthcare should ingrain. Every healthcare should ingrain within it spiritual values of karuna, satya, seva, satatya, samadhan. Karuna, you should understand the pain and suffering of people, not as an opportunity to raise you, but as an opportunity to heal him. There is a difference. When you see as an opportunity to heal it and to raise yourself, there comes this very uncomfortable knack of your mind to have selfish goals. So karuna has to be there. Karuna in the point of perspective of the person ahead. Satya, it has to be very precise. You don't require 10 words to explain a truth. Just 2 words are enough. So if it is true, it is obviously beneficial to the people. So that truth has to be there, and that truthfulness has to be at level of 3 parts. It should be in the level of the patient or the community also. It should be at the level of the service also, and it should be at the level of the service provider or the doctor or the diagnostic person, any aspects of healthcare. What is the truth that a doctor should have? The truth is what he is prescribing, he knows it, whether it is right or wrong, whether it is the most cheapest or the more costliest. whether it is indicated or not indicated, what diagnosis he is doing, whether he is over-diagnosing, whether he is doing under-diagnosis, whether he is just doing right or wrong, he knows it better. Because if he doesn't know it, he has to omit it. He doesn't have to offer something. Because if he knows it, he has to go ahead. That is what I talk of truthfulness. Seva is just serve these people. I see people, because I being from Ayush based services, a promoter of Ayush based services, and into what it's my pain that they call it as an alternative system, but myself being from alternative system, that is how it is defined, Ayush as alternative system of medicine. So I see that whenever some patients who are taking alternative type of treatments and they go to a consultant, a patient can very easily discuss his medications, his health issues with a alternative system person. But suppose if he wants to discuss it with a consultant, he is under burden, he is under pressure, he can't. Because it is not expected, it is not allowed to question a doctor. I say this is not right, Seva. Every patient should be able to communicate with the doctor. Every patient has a right to know about what he's been treated for. Every patient has to be counseled before a treatment. It is done in the West. Why not in our country? Same doctors, when we go to the West, we are doing it because there the law of liability is there. In India, we don't have law of liability. So they are God. They are godly. So they need not be questioned, right? So this has to change. There is where I come with the word seva. Every person, every healthcare provider, now in this, a doctor, a yoga person, a therapist, or an Ayush person, anybody who come in this category, for everyone it is very necessary that you are not the God. The person who is coming across your door, who is walking inside, who is trusting you, he is God. He is your annadata. He is your advertisement. He is your presence. He is your success. Because without him, you are nothing. So that part of seva I am talking about. Satatya, repeatability. Not for a fluke moment, not for a day, not for a 2 day. These all good ingrained qualities that are we are talking about as spiritual values, they should come every time, repeat, 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 repeat. Same thing. Samadhan, satisfaction, not for you. Satisfaction for the person. The person, if it's satisfied, I will tell you, you will feel satisfied. I have lots of turning points in my life. I love the movie Patch Adams. I hope you must have seen Munabhai MBBS or something which derived from there. But my one of my loved actors, Robin Williams, no more. I loved him. I loved to watch him. And I loved this movie Patch Adams based on a true story. He also, the whole movie, it talks about feeling satisfied, you know, and that satisfaction comes from serving people, solving their problems, healing them. That samadhan I'm talking about. If that samadhan is there, I say it is a spiritual value in healthcare. Now, how are we going to do this karuna, satya, seva, satatya, samadhan and connect with the patient? It will start with something called as bhav. Sir told me how you describe me as Atma, Veda and Yoga. How I understand Atma. To understand Atma, most important thing is Bhav. Bhav is not what you feel. Bhav is what you intend. Before doing something, before following God, your intent has to be very clear. Why are you doing it? In the process, no doubt it may change, it may disintegrate, something new will come up, which is right. But if that intent is not right, you will not understand the process. So this bhav, regarding healthcare, our intention has to be very clear. What is the intent? What is the intention that we are wanting this healthcare to make? Expression, bhavna. Now, people who are hearing me, they will say, is he trying to preach? We are talking of healthcare and what is this bhava, bhavana and samvad that we are seeing? Now, my friends, Ekam Tattva, that is the thing which is said in Veda. Conciseness of Veda is Ekam Bhav, Ekam Tattva. Nothing more than that. To explain this, whole Veda is written. Now, when I say Ekam Tattva, it means all principles everywhere, they belong the same. They mean the same. They have to be followed the same. Only its application might be different. So when I say intention, it is about example. Let's take my own example. Atma Veda Yog Private Limited, a corporate, a small startup. It is formed with an intention. That intention is clear. So everybody has that intention. That bhav will define what it is going to do. Because bhavana expression is what that particular institution, what that particular startup, corporate, government, anybody, how are they going to be seen in healthcare? Like what type of services they will bring, what type of unit they will create, what type of work they will do, what type of charges they are going to take, everything from social to commercial to finance, everything. These are expressions. So I see bhavana in that part. I cannot ask anyone, I cannot believe someone by the words what he is saying. Expression is seen from action. It is visible. That visibility in healthcare, that is bhavana, samvad. Now, when there is a samvad between this expression and intention, forget the patient, it comes later. The samvad between, the communication between what you are planting as a healthcare with what is the intention for what you are doing. This samvad, if it is clear, if it is unidirectional, if it is, clearly, precisely marked, I tell you that healthcare will go in that particular direction. Now, if example, if this bhavana is all about karuna, seva, satya, satatya and samadhan, then the samvad is going to be the same. The healthcare that is going to come out of this particular branch or this particular seed is going to be same. And that will be the atmaras and the atmanirbharta. So that will come from that. If we go ahead, how we should bring healthcare with these spiritual values, you know. Why am I talking about it here? A great platform to talk on this topic, because the name itself, ancient wisdom, right? Wisdom is not intellect. This is what I have understood. I was intellectual before. I don't know whether I have the wisdom now. But I understood my intellect is not wisdom, because I was unable to see what I could see after 14 years. So before 14 years, my intellect was there. My resources was there. But that wisdom was not there. When you bring the spiritual values, you will have this wisdom. Intellect is something which we can collect. Intellect, collect. So what you collect, that is intellect. Resource, what you have, you yourself, your values, and what you have gathered or what persons you have, I say the investors, the funders, they are also resource. You yourself, the bootstrapped startups, they are the resource. So intellect and resource, along with spiritual values, you will go into wisdom. Somebody, if he thinks I am greatly intellectual and I will create the best healthcare, I think he may fail, because intellectual compartment of our brain gives certain abilities, not all abilities. But if you garnish it, if you marinate it with spiritual values, it gives you wisdom. It gives you immense intellectual powers which you have not gathered, which somebody has showered on you. And that what I am talking about. So we have to bring wisdom in healthcare. Going ahead, healthcare built on spiritual values, ancient wisdom, ancient sciences and Vedas. My country, whole globe, somehow it is running after making these sciences scientific. I doubt whether they can, do that, because our science is grade 1 of this education of life sciences, and Vedas, it is grade beyond doctorate. So how can a first standard student try to make scientific something that is in a such higher class? So don't just be scientific, you have to be real, you know. Science, okay, but science has a limitation. Anything beyond science we call unscientific. We call unscientific because we have no explanation to give it. We have no tools to show it. We have nothing in our capacity to talk about it. When such thing comes, we label it as unscientific or philosophical or something magical. Ancient wisdom, ancient sciences, and our Vedas. Vedas being the mother of science and wisdom, they give us so much immense inputs. If we read every word of it, maybe we'll not be able to recollect, but if we understand the meaning of it, it is so concise, so short, so small that you can explore it. So what you will explore once you understand our ancient sciences or spiritual values regarding healthcare, I will talk about that. That is my perspective. You learn, don't learn it, learn the purpose. I mean, we'll not learn the intellect. We'll not try to learn for being intellectual. We'll try to learn the purpose for what our mind is, the purpose for what the intelligence is. Learn the principle, Satyam Shivam Sundaram, not something from a movie, not something to say in Sanskrit, but it's like bringing truthfulness in all parts of healthcare. For example, if a patient walks my door, he sits with me, he discusses with me, when I write investigation to him, I know what is necessary and what is not necessary. My truthfulness will come there. What does it do? It makes me precise. It makes me concise, and most important, it saves his money. If my ability to diagnose on my skills is good, I will be able to save his money, and most important, do correct diagnosis rather than right, left, in many directions. If I go, it will be haywire. So that is what I talk about. When I want to prescribe him any medicine, if I want to plan his treatment, I am the best person to know whether he requires what type of treatment, whether he should be given very costly drugs or some basic drugs, whether he should be admitted, he should not be admitted, and the most important thing, whether the treatment is possible at my end or not. I should very bluntly accept that this is not possible for me, it is beyond my scope. If I say that, what happens? The patient doesn't waste time with me. He goes to some other place. So, if he does that, this truthfulness in giving him the treatment, giving him option of treatment, I say that, yes, this is spiritual. Any person need not be spiritual. I don't see Abdul Kalam ji as a spiritual person, but whatever word I heard from him, whatever quotes I heard from him, whatever life he lived, it's spiritual. You did not understand God, you understand the qualities, the principles, the actions, the process. If you understand this, it is spiritual. So bringing spiritual values into healthcare is about this. If we go ahead, how and what I have done, let's come to my work. I can only talk about myself. I have no rights to talk about other healthcare. I have no right to preach anyone. So what have we done? I will elaborate 5 words and the 6th word also. And I will allow you to think, what are these words? Anubhuti, Nirodha, Nidan, Adhar, Samadhan, and Sakshatkar. Now, if I talk this and if I just change my clothes to some white clothes with some rudrakshas or maybe a saffron, maybe some other colorful dress, it will look spiritual. It will mean I am a spiritual person. I am a person of some disciple of some very some big person. Now, I understood. I understood this word in my context. Anubhuti, awareness. Isn't spirituality about awareness? Isn't yoga about awareness? I love to call it as yoga. Nothing against those who call it as yoga. But I love to call it as yoga. So, yoga brings awareness. So, if Vedas talk about yoga, if yoga talks about itself, so many Rishi Munis, they have defined yoga, they have made so many asanas. It is for some purpose, right? And the purpose was not self-goals, it was about serving humanity, giving a direction, giving some solutions. I am very sure that must be the purpose that time also. So what I have done is, what my startup is doing is, we are using this awareness, which is related to yoga, to make it as a solution technique in diagnostic and therapy. Now, when I say diagnostic, I talk about precise diagnostic. I use yoga to diagnose anything from simple stress to cancer, and with very, very perfect precision. Now, if you say me, do you diagnose which part of the body has cancer? No. Every diagnostic solution, every diagnostic test, it has its scope, it has its limitation. Like ECG, it will only tell about the conductivity of the heart. It will not talk about the sizes of the heart, though somewhere it will give us some ideas. So X-ray, it will only talk about the lung. It will not talk about the lung vasculature. So for me, when I was in that 14 years of research, I was knowing the limitation of medical science. Limitation of medical science was, it was only able to see a disease or diagnose a disease once it has started. For example, if you are having a problem in the liver, it will be only diagnosed when your liver enzymes in your blood investigations come abnormal, or your sonography shows some issues, or a CT scan shows some issues. If you go to a doctor before that, it will be something called as empirical treatment. He won't be able to diagnose. Our ancient sciences, our Ayush based therapies, yoga being the pioneer in it. For me, yoga is the pioneer. It is the guiding light for all medical sciences. Someday they will realize it. We are doing it. Based on yoga, when I do certain tests designed, innovated from yoga, I am able to see something which the medical science is not able to see. To be very, very precise, not to showcase what best we are, but let's be very blunt, let's be very straightforward, what we have done in these 2 years. In these 2 years, we are the person who were able to understand how is the mutation of COVID going to happen, what are going to be the likely mutations. We did not give it the names, but we understood how, when, why the peak is going to happen, not only India, all over the globe. We communicated with the government agencies, we communicated with the higher up central agencies, maybe a letter to the PMO also, to the ministries also. And I'm very sure they have in the record. So if they see that, they will see this is the only person, this is the only startup with precise predictions before anybody else in the world. It means what? Not that we are good. It means yogic vision, our own spiritual related life science, Ayush based, because whole of Ayush is based on spirituality, you know. So this science, it has such immense power that it can see something, it can do something with the present medical science. There is a limitation. So when a scope is there and when there is a limitation, if somebody else is doing something good in it, if they integrate, it increases the scope of whole medical science. Nirodha, prevention. Now, prevention, we say run, change your lifestyle. We are more into general, you know, general prevention. Atmaveda Yoga, it is involved in precise prevention. What I mean by precise prevention? Suppose, I don't know how many people are attending this session, but suppose we are 10 people. Suppose, if I say for 10 people, I want to give you some, I want to hear from you some solution to reduce stress, some solution to reduce lethargy, some solution to be energetic. I'm very sure so many yoga people will give many things. They are good also. Some medicine, some kadha, something they will do. General prevention, general wellness, general awareness, you know. Atmaveda yoga is about precise. If there are 10 people, 10 people are not the same. They look different, they think different. Their organs work different. Their harmony inside is different. Their whole structure is different. So even if they have the same problem, the causation will be different. So identify what is a problem in that person or a community. When we work on a large scale, like in COVID, we worked on a large scale for prevention. We were very successful to work in some villages where we had the access during the first lockdown, and we could prevent those villages from getting infected more. So that is the thing when I say of Nirodha, prevention. So based on yoga, if what Atma we have understood, what Veda has given us the knowledge, and what yoga has allowed us to combine all this, make the union, that prevention will be very, very fruitful. It will become the best medicine. Nidan diagnosis, just like in Anubhuti I said, precise diagnosis saves 80% of your cost. 80% of your cost is saved by this right diagnosis. Most of the times, doctors or the investigation procedures or the diagnostic methods, limitation, doctors are limited by the diagnostic tools. If they are not able to diagnose, we do 10 things, we go in 10 directions, the disease has spread, they are misdiagnosed, they are interrelated to separate organs, and then the expenses are all borne by the patient. So precise diagnosis, good Nidan will help making healthcare spiritual, because you are again thinking from the point of the patient. Aadhar, realistic hope. This is a point which I want to elaborate. I will take some few minutes from you. What is this point? Support, I see most doctors give support, but when it comes to something which their pathy, which their system is not able to solve, they tell that person, oh no, this is going to be the end. I mean, they are God. Do they know when is the death of a patient? No. I have seen this treating almost 50,000-60,000 of COVID patients all over India, and I have great questions to the healthcare. This should not happen. This is not human. You should give hope. If you are not able to solve it, it doesn't make the end of the road. Please tell the patient, this is the best I can do. Please try something else. Now here, don't be egoistic and don't block something which is going to save the patient. Be ready to explore, because it is his life, not your life. If you were at that end, then you would have done the same thing what he is doing. He is helpless today. So realistic hope. On the other hand, many times I see some people, especially from my branches, Ayush, maybe other branches also, we boast that this will be solved. No. We know our capability, we know our limitation, we know our knowledge, we know our resources. Be very true to it. Don't give a person who is in hopeless position hope just to earn money. That is truthfulness, what I say, spiritual values in healthcare. Because person who is helpless, he is in such a situation, he will just sell his home, sell his wife's ornaments, sell his daughter's savings, what he has made for his daughter's marriage or education, just because you have given him hope. So don't do that. So if we take this care, I tell you, the healthcare will be very spiritual. It will be low cost. It will be giving us samadhan. What is samadhan? Solution. Now, solution has been such, if your science is so good, it is, no doubt about it, save life, defeat death. Modern healthcare has saved lots of lives. Lots of lives. Because it was in their scope, but COVID has broken that. They have showed them their limitations. For every system of medicine, it has shown certain limitations. So when your passion is to save life, when your passion is to defeat death, integrate. See that the person who is coming to you for your service, he is satisfied. His satisfaction is only possible when you give a solution which saves his life, which solves his problem. So, Sakshatkar is like whole conciseness of spirituality, Sakshatkar, Darshan, understanding God. For me, Atma is patient, Veda is patient, Yoga is patient. I see God in him. I understand beyond diagnosis. When I see a person, when he comes to me with a problem, I not just see him, I imagine what his family should be, what financial burden it will bring on him, what is his status, what pain, what happiness, what agony, what turmoil he's going through. If you want to understand spirituality, if you want to understand God, if you don't understand this pain, turmoil, agony and of other person, you will never be able to understand Atma. Siddhartha, he was also a prince. He changed into Buddha when he understood that pain. Understanding the pain is not about writing an essay. It is about you feel that pain within you. Ekam bhav, ekam tattva. What is your aham brahmasi. If you are the Brahman, then whatever he is having, it should affect you also. It should relate with you also. That you, that I, and that him, make it one. If you can do that, you will understand diagnosis, not just to his organs, his cells, you'll go beyond it. Once you go beyond that point, then whatever healthcare service you are providing, it will be for him, it will be for his family, it will be for his society, and have no doubts, it will be for our beloved nation. Because food, education, and healthcare, these are basic things what every countryman should get. Presently, we are running after great technological upscale in healthcare. Will it reach the poor? Yes, it should. With the leadership that we are having, it should. But the way for it to reach ahead is bringing spiritual values into healthcare. I should be very blunt and very straightforward to say you that whatever I have spoken in this session, as a corporate company, as a startup, you call it any name, it is only Atma, Veda and Yoga. It is assured that whenever anybody takes our help, anybody holds our hand, whatever hopeless situation he is, we are the ray of hope. So generally we say, because the obligation and liability comes on me, it starts with me. So I represent a team. So I always say to the world that where everything stops in medical science, we begin. Because that is the power of yoga, that is the power which comes from Veda, and that is the immense intellectual wisdom, immense intellectual capacity that you get from Atma. So that is it. I conclude here. I'm sorry if it got little prolonged. I'm sorry if it was out of the context, but I can only speak that much. Which I know, which I do, and which I am capable of doing. So that's it. So very thank you to the School of Ancient Wisdom and all the honored guests. The father-like figure who introduced me, Sajani Ma, who gave me this opportunity. Thank you. And 10, 5, 4, 3, 1, whoever are there in today's session, if there are any questions, doubts, it could be very blunt criticism. Because it will allow me to correct also myself ahead. You are very free to ask me for that. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sadanand, for this very interesting and inspiring talk. And now, if there are any questions, please ask the speaker the questions. Any questions, anyone?
Yes, Sajani.
Atma Yoga, Ved, healthcare.
Yeah, I have a question, Sajani.
Yes, Ramesh.
Okay. Am I audible?
Yes, yes, Ramesh ji.
Okay, ji. Okay. Dr. Sadanand, that was amazing. I think what you spoke today was really, for me, it is part of my wish. But before I continue, I just want to fill you in that we had about 28 participants today. And I think the gentleman who introduced you was Dr. Janaki Ram. Janaki Ramji. He was the one who introduced you today. Now, whatever you spoke today was something that for me sounds very right. I've been a seeker myself, and I always strongly felt that healthcare is actually a spiritual, it's a compassion-based activity. It cannot be purely corporate. Of course, it has to have some component of corporate to look after itself and to remain healthy itself, to exist. But its existence is mainly for the purpose, compassionate purpose of supporting people to heal, and more importantly, to prevent them from falling ill in the first place, if the right methodology is followed. So I'm very, I'm happy and blessed to have really heard you today. Later on, I mean, of course, I want to also ask you if there is such an institution here in Bangalore, because your institution is in Pune. So that would be lovely. I mean, I'd love to meet the right people here in Bangalore if possible. Now, I have a question. You see, I'm an automotive designer, and during my research for my car design project, which was, related to spirituality also, I came across the fact, this was a few years back, that there were about 40 countries which used alternative therapy. The Kirlian camera, the measurement of the aura, etc. This kind of alternative therapy was used in many countries around the world. The numbers are growing. Of course, in India, it's very limited at the moment. But whatever you spoke about diagnosis, it is very strongly showing up in this alternative therapy, where before any symptoms are seen in the Annamaya Kosha, the material body, the Pranamaya Kosha, which can be diagnosed also, and maybe the other koshas too, you'll probably be able to enlighten us. That kind of diagnosis is definitely available. In fact, our ancient sages used to do it. Where does India stand when it comes to, say, Pranamaya Kosha or bioelectrical diagnosis before it manifests in the body? Like 3 to 6 months in advance, you might know that the person may be having a heart attack or might get cancer or some other problem, and take preventive action before it shows up in the body. Is that kind of a diagnosis available here in India now? Is it growing?
Yes, it's available in front of you. Maybe something which the globe may not be able to do for next 2 decades with the best of the technology. You being from the mechanical field, every mechanics will be based on science, right? Some scientific principle. So you are starting from a defined, so you will reach a defined. 2 things are very important. If I'm starting with a number, I'm going to end with a number. If I'm starting with alphabets, I will end with alphabet. I can make sentence, paragraph, essays, right? When you are talking about having deep diagnosis, okay, I am not representing something as technological diagnosis. I am not into aura scanning. I don't believe in it, number one. Okay, it doesn't mean that it is wrong. Every person has a different approach, right? When a patient comes to me, I want precise diagnosis. What is precise diagnosis for me? I should be able to see something before it happens, number one. Then only I can give him good prevention. I should be able to see something which is happening in him, but the best diagnostic procedure invented by the best in the world, they are missing it. So I should have good diagnostic tool to diagnose, number one. Number two, I should be able to have a diagnostic method which even diagnoses the progression of a disease. For example, you have simple hypertension today, and I want to have a such method which not a generalized thing. I want to have a precise thing where it tells me whether you are going to go into cardiomyopathy, whether you are going to go into cardiac failure, or whether you are going to go into ischemic heart disease, or whether you are going to go with coronary artery disease, or whether you are going to go into something which now is a big problem, which is called the cardiac run, right? So it should guide that, because any medical person, okay, let it be yoga, let it be Ayurveda, homeopathy, naturopathy, allopathy, consultant, super consultant, what, who he rides on, what he rides on inputs. Maybe everybody has the solution, but if you don't know the way, I want to come to your home, sir, and if you give me only Bangalore as address, I don't know where I will reach. So if I want to reach your home, I have to have a precise address. That address is called diagnosis. That diagnosis tools, I tell you, I am just trying, somebody challenges our tool, not to boost our best, because that gives you a chance to break from this thought that we are the best in the globe, forget India. So yes, India is coming into diagnosis, they are following the West. Like we are coming with small electrical gadgets, you know, we are measuring pulse, BP, temperature, we are measuring the oxygen level. We are measuring lifestyle, sleep, how many hours, what. Maybe after some day, we will have a complete biochemical report from the body itself. Now tell me, what else it is going to do to you? You are going into a lab, you are getting the report. They are not able to diagnose. So how is this same technology going to diagnose? Because it is based on the same science. Understood? Now, if the same technology outputs what they are coming, the data what is coming from this, it is fed to the same system which is giving solution, present system. So the solutions are the same. So I don't see any change in the healthcare. Yes, only it will look little technological savvy, tech savvy. Okay, we will call it as reach or something like that. So if you are looking for something very precise, okay, which diagnosis, you talked about kosha, you talked about one kosha, I am talking about five kosha, right from Annamaya kosha to Anandamaya kosha. Okay, I don't understand God. I am not capable of understanding God. So I am not talking of Vijnanamaya kosha or Anandamaya kosha as God. I understand Vijnanamaya kosha as intercellular environment. To make it very simple, anything that is happening inside a cell, that is Vijnanamaya kosha, that is the science which defines you. When I talk of Anandamaya kosha, I am talking of intranuclear science that happens. That is the point of my research, where I talk about cellular diagnostics, cellular aging, reversal of cellular injury, understanding cellular injury, understanding disease progression, understanding systemic and diagnostic, utility of this particular thing, right? Now, India, it is so rich. I am a no one in India, right? We have so many gurus, so many big institutions, so many yoga persons, so many big dignitaries who run very big things, research things. But I find they are into science. They are trying to make yoga scientific. You can make yoga scientific up to that limit where science has the capability. Like for example, I am treating certain cases of liver cell failure, cardiac failure and pancreatic destruction because of COVID. The world is not talking about it. We are already doing it for almost since inception of COVID, right? Now, if we are doing this, do I have the tool to analyze how COVID is doing that? No. So, but our tool, it is helping us. So, Ramesh ji, I will tell you, don't get caught in this word called science. I will tell you to being a mechanical person, you are talking about spirituality. It means I have gone 14 years into destructive mode to break my intellect. You also have gone in some part of your time in that. It is very tough to break that intellectual capacity of our brain, you know, because it is imprinted on us, because we call it as our capability. We boost it. I know this. You stop there. So, India, I don't know about Aura. I know about institute in Bangalore, a very reputed institute which does most of the research, Vyasa University, right? So Vyasa University, they do this thing. I don't know what objective they fulfill from that, because whenever I visit the Ayush Ministry, whenever I see the research done, the grants given, I see like cardiac illnesses, so and so, supportive yoga. I hate this word supportive yoga. I say yoga is the primary treatment. someday, when one talks before time, you are a fool. I find myself in that position today. I am very happy in that position. Because when you are able to diagnose people correctly and when you are able to deliver results time after time, and especially in those cases where a limitation for medical science, you yourself understand first you are on the right path. For example, when the world was struggling with low oxygen and deaths, it took us 3 and 6 hours to raise the oxygen from 50 to 90, not in one patient, many, many patients. When the world was talking about permanent organ injuries in COVID, post-COVID patients, we have n number of patients. I have shared some video, not for advertisement purpose, but to motivate people. Don't lose hope. Just because your doctor has said you there is no answer, don't stop your search, you know. Maybe your doctor, like if I don't know anything, I say I don't know anything. That is my limitation. It cannot be end of the knowledge, right? If there are 33 koti Devi Devata, it means every God had some limitation. He went to other person, he was a God. If one was supreme, then only one was there. Na? We have 33 koti specialists in our Vedas. They are depicted like that. So many specialists who are better than us, they already exist. How can we say that we are the last one and we are the only one to know about it? So I have seen 90, I don't want to use the word 100% because people will immediately pounce on me. 95% plus destructed lungs, completely rehabilitated. Complete rehabilitation, liver, heart, your brain diseases, within hours, they were survived. In a month, their organs were completely recovered. Now, problem with this is that people have to communicate it. So, my request, sorry, I took a little long to answer you. Because I see you have taken that effort to come from mechanical to spirituality. Okay. So you have taken the effort from coming from the zone of known scientific powers to something beyond science. Don't go back, sir. Don't go into the aura. Don't go into those things. It will limit you. Mind my words. I don't see them reaching anywhere. Unless and until something we are used to, like PET scans, positive electron tomography, something like that. This technology doesn't evolve much. They can't do more about it. Because the problem is, if you see one of our reports, we diagnose it pre-functional, pre-pathological and pathological. Now you see the beauty of it. Pre-functional is something which a person is not aware of. I am telling you some problems which you are not aware of. Now, if you are not aware, how can the doctor find in the diagnostic thing? Now, this awareness is not about that you are having a hole in the heart and you are not aware. I am not talking of that. It is not seen in any level. Neither your intellect, neither your body, neither any expression, neither in the blood reports or any test, neither any symptom. Now, how are you going to find it? So I call it as pre-functional, before any change in the function. When it is a functional, only you can understand it. Doctor cannot understand it. You have a headache, you have a stomach ache, you have a leg pain, you have back pain, you have little palpitation, you have certain different things, you feel breathless. You go to a doctor, all reports come normal. 90% of reports of every patient, they come normal. Doctor says nothing, you are taking tension, it is anxiety, go home, take a tablet. He gives you a sedative, he gives you a tranquilizer, you take it, you subdue your brain, you block your neurotransmitters, you think you have solved, you have fallen into a trap now. We are able to diagnose functional changes.
Wonderful.
I didn't get you, sir.
Do you have a setup like your... Do you have a similar setup here in Bangalore, which is similar to what you have?
We are looking for my colleague, Ganesh.G, if he is here. My vision is very bad, so I cannot, I have to go down like that. I am operating from mobile. He was there. So Ganesh.G is looking after Bangalore thing. We are trying to collaborate with people. We are trying to come up in Bangalore. Maybe our goal is, you know, such a beautiful PM. Sorry again, I'm not advertising our PM. It's a very big problem, even if we say good about something which is good. I mean, he wants to, first time in the world, you have someone who is talking of Ayushman Bharat. First time in the world, you have a person in such a high chair who is talking of Ayush, promoting Ayush. Only my pain with him is, he's only talking of Ayurveda. So my pain is that, personal pain, because Ayush is whole. We should talk about yoga. We should talk as yoga, as the guide for all yoga medicine. How it is, maybe there might be more good people than us, but presently we know the key, how it is. So we could just show the way, look, this is the way, then there could be more better people, more influential people. I don't know anybody, I have not googled anyone today. I don't know who Ramesh ji is, I don't know the fatherly figure who introduced me, I don't know who Sajani ji is, I don't know anyone. So these people, you know, they can maybe work more than me. My job is what? Just to, you are a mechanic, mala starter. I have to just give a starter, you know. So the starter is right, but I don't know how many engines I am able to start. So that is it. Looking forward, you know, Bangalore, I am looking forward, surely, that way.
Thank you, sir. There's a question in the chat. It's from S.M. Kapoor. As a patient, when you're diagnosed of a serious disease and undergo treatment and prescribed medicines for a long time, and when you consult another specialist doctor and he prescribes simple medicine for a couple of weeks and tells you that you're all right, you get perplexed. Could you guide what should the patient do?
I mean, what should the patient do? It is a very tough question, sir. Onus lies on your doctor to diagnose you correctly. If the first doctor who prescribes you the best medicine, what he feels is there, and if it is a case of overdiagnosis, we have seen some, we do see some patients like that, where we don't have any, position to comment on their prescription. But yes, we are also from medical field. We have understood allopathy quite well, though we don't prescribe allopathy. We do understand it. We do understand what is necessary and what is not necessary. So if you as a patient, let's take you as a patient. If you as a patient go to Dr. A, he gives you 12 medicines. Now you are just going to a temple. You are offering him the puja thali. God takes it or man takes it. Who blesses? It is your trust. You are trusting it, right? So you are trusting that doctor, my friend. So it is his onus what to give you, right? The next doctor who has given you less medicine, if he has diagnosed you rightly, if he has without any wrong tactics, before, without bad shaming the doctor before, he has quietly reduced the medicines and given you the right medications, which could be two or three only, which are needed, that much only needed to you. I tell you, never leave such doctor. He is like a god. He is being very true to you. He is passionate about you, wants to heal you. His primary purpose is that. So don't, generally, from a patient point of view, I will tell you, I talked about healthcare from doctor's perspective, but there is a perspective of patient mindset also. You get that products in the market which you demand. So I see present healthcare, the reason of present healthcare is patient themselves, public themselves. If public is judging from the cost of a prescription, from what type of big companies medicines they are giving, how good medicine he is giving, you will get it. And it will be wrong. But if a public is judging on how right medicine a patient is getting, so I would, if such is the case like yours, one has prescribed 12 medicines, one has prescribed 4 medicines, I will tell you, there are lot many cases where you can visit and where you can get idea about understanding your disease process correctly, not taking treatment. I could be one of that. Don't take treatment for me, but understand your disease diagnosis correctly. Once you have that diagnosis correct, I will tell you, you take that diagnosis to the doctor, show him. I mean, every doctor knows what is the intellectual capacity or the value or the strength of a doctor's prescription or diagnostic letter, he won't challenge that. So like that, you have to find someone. I find a family doctor. The concept of family doctor is the best one. Every family is connected to a doctor. So you should always consult with your family doctor, because he never is interested in just business with you. So very, very tricky question, very tough question to answer. What you can do, I don't know, sir. Because self-care is good, self-judgment is good. But in such situation, how can you judge about your illness? So I will advise you, it's onus on the doctor. Find a good doctor who diagnosis is very correct. Once you diagnose, go on the Google. See every drug, see every content, what is there, write down on a paper, adverse effect, indication. Next time when you consult the doctor, don't talk about your illness. Just inquire politely, this medicine has this problem, will I have it? Doctor may feel offended, because in India, doctors don't like to be questioned this way, you know. In West, it happens. So once you do that once or twice, every doctor wants a patient. He can't just abuse you, he can't just show you ego. He has to answer it. If he is very correct, he will answer every question. If he doesn't answer, stop going to that doctor. This is my answer, Kapoor sir.
Yes, sir. And now with this, we have come to the end of the program. I request Ramesh to propose a formal vote of thanks, followed by the Loka Samasta. Over to you, Ramesh.
Thanks, Sajani. And we'd love to contact you again, doctors. So if you let us know how we can do that, or Ganesh ji, that would be wonderful, because there are people in there are chat messages here which indicate that we'd like that contact number.
Little louder.
Oh, am I audible now?
Yes.
Okay, one minute. Let me just check the volume here. Okay, must be better now. Right. So let me just open the. I was jotting down some notes as Dr. Sadanand spoke. First of all, Sadanand ji, I can't thank you enough. I'm not only an engineer, I'm also a designer. And so I have my right and left brain both equally active, but they're both active, equally otherwise. So I very much understand where you're coming from. In fact, people like you probably are the dream doctors from my perspective, because I always felt that healing a person has to be from a compassion-based stance. And spirituality is the best way. I believe spirituality really is a very high-level science. It is not, it is actually a very high-level science. So our modern science is a science in its infancy. So spirituality has many more dimensions that have to be uncovered for effective healthcare. So when you spoke about your Atma Veda Yoga, I pray that this style of healthcare becomes not alternative but mainstream healthcare in India. I remember reading predictions about how the Indian Sanatana Dharma philosophy will start this brand of philosophy, which is, you know, which includes the Vasudeva Kutumbakam, the whole world, will start becoming visible in many different parts of the world in the next 10 to 15 years. And probably Bharat will be at the forefront of guiding the world in opening its eyes. And I can definitely see this form of healthcare, you know, taking up on this kind of a development in big time, not just in Bharat, but around the world. And I really pray that it happens. And when you spoke about, you know, your very practical approach to healthcare and your diagnosis and the panchakoshas, I felt that if we all can get exposure to this kind of healthcare here in Bangalore, maybe through Mr. Ganesh ji and others, that'll be wonderful. And whatever you're doing right now, I would love to contact you in the future. Maybe through your website, I could contact you. So because I'm sure there are many people, I've met many doctors like yourself, who may not be, of course, who may not have researched so in depth, who may not have taken time off from the material world to dwell into their own spiritual dimension, but who will also benefit, you know, from the research that you have gone through, and very clearly from a practice, from your ability to handle this pandemic in such a seemingly incredible manner, which many presidents and royalty around the world don't have access to. I mean, obviously there is something behind what you're doing, which we all should get the benefit of. And I really can't thank you enough. I'd love to contact you again, but I'm very grateful that we met you today. And I do hope that in the future, we have more sessions with you at the school as well, if possible. So thank you so much for all the dimensions that you've opened up for us. Because I think through a simple talk, you've actually opened up a new dimension of personal well-being, not just healthcare, but personal well-being, mind, body, and spirit. So thank you.
Yes, thank you, Ramesh ji. I have thanked everyone, but I should thank Ganesh ji, my partner, my soul, and Varalakshmi Amma. I am sure Varalakshmi Amma is the person who was a source to brought up this meeting. So, like you said, how to connect with me? Atma, Veda, and Yoga, it connects from soul to soul, sir. I connected with Ganesh ji connected with Varalakshmi Amma. Maybe connected with Sajani Amma. I don't know how the connection happens. So yes, looking forward to meet everyone. I just saw a message, how to connect your contact details. I think my contact details should be the School of Ancient Wisdom that way, because everything has to go. Yes, so everything has to go through a truth way, and the first, if I have a corporate with spiritual values, the first value is honor those persons who give you the platform. So yes, whoever wants to connect with me, no doubt it could be connected with me anytime, but I would love it if it is through the School of Ancient Wisdom. I might even spell it wrong. I have a big problem in my yeah, somewhere, sometimes names, numbers, I am not able to write to recite. So that way we can connect. Ganesh ji is the person who looks after everything, who looks after me like a father, brother, partner, everything. So my job is, my square is very limited. Research, understanding, solution, innovation. And cure. That places, that conditions where world will say we can't. That is my speciality, right? So Ganesh ji's speciality, if he feels, that is how it started, if he feels we are true, if he feel I am right, if he feel this is right, he will take me wherever. I will just follow his steps. So Ramesh ji, Ganesh ji is my boss here. So that way, Sajani Amma is my boss here. You are my boss here. All are here. So,
Sadan, how, we are lucky how to connect? Have yes. you here in the group.
We will connect Thank and you get for, you to the school, doctor. We will call yes, you to yes. the school to give a talk face to face.
Thank you, ma'am. Great faith on you. I will just say that your faith, your belief will be utmost honored. You will not feel I have done something wrong to call this guy here. Be assured that way.
All right. So thank you, everyone. And we look forward to meeting you again next Thursday. Next Thursday, we have an open house. Anuja Sharma will moderate and all of you will participate. All the participants will participate. It's an open house. Please join us and ask more people to join us also. Okay?
Yes. Right. Thank you. Yes, Atma Malik.
Thank you. Okay. Yeah. Goodbye, everyone.
Yeah.